Hello everyone, my name is Akshay Shetty. I'm a PG student at University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, and I work with Professor Grace Gao at Stanford University. Today, I will be presenting about our research on trajectory planning under stochastic and bounded sensing uncertainties using stochastic reachability. First, let's take a look at why it is important to consider uncertainty for trajectory planning. The presence of uncertainties such as motion uncertainties and sensing uncertainties leads to uncertainty in the state of the system. The state of the system typically consists of the position and the orientation of the system. Here is a quick video of what might happen if we don't consider state uncertainty during trajectory planning. Here we plan a straight trajectory in between the buildings in an urban canyon. However, as the UAS gets closer to the buildings, errors in GNSS measurements results in the UAS deviating from the planned trajectory, which ultimately leads to a collision. Thankfully, this was only a simulated flight. This shows the need for predicting state uncertainty along candidate trajectories to ensure collision safety. For example, in this scenario, we predict the state uncertainty along two trajectories. The predicted state uncertainty along this trajectory intersects with the obstacles, which determines this trajectory to be unsafe. On the other hand, the predicted state uncertainty along this trajectory does not intersect with any of the neighboring obstacles, determining this trajectory to be safe for the UAS. In order to predict the state uncertainty, previous works assume either a stochastic or a bounded sensing uncertainty model. However, such an assumption is not always valid. For example, GNSS pseudorange measurements are typically modeled to contain stochastic uncertainties plus an additional bias due to multipath and NLOS effects, as shown over here. NLOS biases are generally tens of meters, and various outlier rejection and 3D map-based methods have been proposed to detect and exclude them. Multipath biases, on the other hand, are relatively lower, and there exists previous works that provide bounds for the bias, given information about the 3D map and the receiver architecture. Thus, for GNSS pseudoranges in urban environments, we need to consider both stochastic and bounded uncertainties. In our prior work, we took initial steps to account for both stochastic and bounded sensing uncertainties and predicted state uncertainty along a candidate trajectory using stochastic reachability. In the formulation, we recursively predicted both the state uncertainty and the state estimation uncertainty. Here, the state uncertainty refers to states that can be realized during the state execution, and state estimation uncertainty refers to errors in the state estimation that can be realized. The state uncertainty was obtained as a function of the previous state uncertainty, the previous state estimation uncertainty, and the previous motion and sensing uncertainties. Similarly, the state estimation uncertainty was obtained as a function of the previous state estimation uncertainty and the previous motion and sensing uncertainties. This process was followed recursively to predict the state uncertainty along the trajectory. However, while computing the state uncertainty, we ignored the correlation between the previous state uncertainty and the previous state estimation uncertainty. Notice that both of these quantities depend on their previous motion and sensing uncertainties. Ignoring this correlation leads to an imperfect approximation of the state uncertainty, which is not desirable during trajectory planning. Thus, the key contributions of this work are stated as follows. First, we improve our prior reachability analysis by predicting state uncertainty as a function of independent and uncorrelated quantities. Next, we design a metric for the predicted state uncertainty in order to compare multiple candidate trajectories in a trajectory planning framework. And finally, we demonstrate the applicability of the trajectory planner for GNSS-based navigation of fixed-wing UAS in urban environments. Here we show results for both a single UAS in a static environment and for multiple UAS in a shared airspace. Here is the outline for the rest of the talk. First, I'll provide a brief idea of stochastic reachability along with the set representations that we use. Then, I'll describe a stochastic reachability analysis that we use to predict the state uncertainty. Next, I'll present the details of the trajectory planner, including the metric we designed for comparing candidate trajectories. And finally, I'll be showing some of the trajectory planner results and then summarizing our work. Generally speaking, reachability analysis consists of computing a set of reachable states given an initial set of states and a set of inputs. In classical reachability, these sets represent bounded uncertainties. This was then extended to stochastic reachability in order to include stochastic uncertainties. In stochastic reachability, the sets contain a probability distribution within the reachable set as shown over here. For our set representation in stochastic reachability analysis, we use probabilistic zonotopes. These are defined as Gaussian zonotopes with an uncertain and bounded mean. Zonotopes are commonly used representation for bounded uncertainties. They are defined with a center and a generator matrix, which determines the shape of the zonotope, as shown over here. For example, over here, the zonotope is defined to have the center at the origin and is defined to have generators, as shown over here. These generators determine the shape of the zonotope. Probabilistic zonotopes include an additional Gaussian component in order to represent the stochastic uncertainty. In the illustration shown over here, we define a probabilistic zonotope with the same bounded uncertainty as for the zonotope example, with an additional Gaussian covariance for the stochastic uncertainty. Notice that probabilistic zonotopes are suitable to capture both stochastic and bounded uncertainties, which is what we use in our reachability analysis. Next, we go through our stochastic reachability analysis. We consider a nonlinear discrete time motion and sensing model as shown over here. For the motion model error, we consider a zero mean Gaussian distribution. For the sensing model error, we consider a Gaussian distribution with an uncertain and bounded mean. For the control law, we assume that the system uses a state feedback control. And for the state estimation, we assume that the system uses an extended Kalman filter. Thus, giving us the following equation for the total control input at any time step along the trajectory. Here, U-norm represents the nominal trajectory inputs, K-norm represents the nominal feedback gains, X-hat represents the online state estimate, and X-norm represents the waypoints along the nominal trajectory. To compute the stochastic reachable sets, we begin by deriving the equation for the system state as a function of independent quantities, which include the initial system state, the initial state estimation error, and the motion and sensing uncertainties along the trajectory. The equation can be written as follows, where the first four terms are independent quantities, as explained over here. The remaining four terms are linearization remainders that arise due to the nonlinear modeling of the system. Here, all phis are matrix coefficients that we obtain recursively from the system matrices mentioned earlier. Next, we extend this equation to the set representation to obtain stochastic reachable sets along the trajectory. Note here that the additions are now Minkowski sum operations. Minkowski sum operations are defined for independent sets, and this is applicable for our scenario since the first four quantities are independent as mentioned earlier. Once we have an expression for the stochastic reachable set, we approximate it to predict the state uncertainty. We make the following approximations. First, we reduce the number of Minkowski sum operations by only considering coefficients with a Frobenius norm higher than a desired threshold. Intuitively, this makes sense because as the trajectory length grows, the effect of the uncertainties seen at the beginning of the trajectory are lower on the current state uncertainty. Next, we use a desired level of Gaussian approximation for the linearization remainders. The method for the Gaussian approximation was presented in our prior work. Thus, the state uncertainty at any point along the trajectory can be obtained using the following expression. Next, let's take a look at the details of the trajectory planner. For the trajectory planner, we use an available and highly parallelizable framework, which we briefly explain over here. The planner begins with a graph building phase. In the graph building phase, the planner samples a bunch of samples in the free space of the environment, as shown over here. Once these samples are produced, the planner then creates a graph of kinematically feasible and collision-free trajectories, as shown. Once the graph is built, it is then explored by considering candidate trajectories, predicting the state uncertainty along these candidate trajectories, and checking for collisions. For example, as shown over here, we show the predicted state uncertainty along two candidate trajectories. The predicted state uncertainty along this candidate trajectory intersects with the obstacles. Hence, the planner would reject this trajectory. During the exploration phase, candidate trajectories are compared in order to remove undesirable trajectories from the graph. The comparison is done in terms of the trajectory length and the size of the predicted state uncertainty. For example, in the situation shown over here, both of these candidate trajectories meet at this final state. Here, these two trajectories are compared based on the trajectory lengths and the sizes of the predicted state uncertainty. Thus determining that this right trajectory is undesirable. Once the goal state is reached, the planner then stops exploring the graph. Hence, in order to merge this trajectory planner with our predicted state uncertainty, we need to design a metric to represent the size of the state uncertainty. Remember that the state uncertainty is represented by a probabilistic zonotope, which can be written as follows, containing a center and a generator matrix for the bounded uncertainty and a Gaussian covariance for the stochastic uncertainty. We first over-approximate the confidence ellipsoid for the Gaussian covariance, as shown over here. The confidence ellipsoid is determined based on the specified collision safety probability. The black bounding box for the over-approximation consists of the spanning vectors which are based on the scalar factor, the eigenvalues of the covariance, and the eigenvectors of the covariance, as shown over here. Once we obtain the over-approximating bounding box, we obtain the overall generator matrix, as shown over here. The gconf matrix is a concatenation of the bounded uncertainties for the predicted state uncertainty and the spanning vectors of the over-approximation of the confidence ellipsoid. Finally, in order to obtain the size metric, we use the covariation of the gconf matrix. The covariation is defined as the trace of the gconf transpose times gconf. Now that we have discussed the details of the trajectory planner, let's take a look at some of the results. For the simulations, we consider a 1 km² urban environment with satellite positions obtained from real ephemeris data. For the motion model, we consider a fixed-wing UAS represented by a 2D Dubin's vehicle. Here, the states of the model are the horizontal position and the heading angle. And for the covariance of the model, we define a diagonal matrix as shown over here. For the measurements, we use GNSS pseudo ranges and compass heading measurements for the state estimation. For the pseudorange bias, we assume that the GNSS receiver has a quarter chip early late correlator spacing, and we perform ray tracing in the environment to obtain the multiplied bias bumps. Here, the ray tracing gives us the differential path lengths at each point in the environment, which helps us obtain the pseudorange biases for multipath. For the stochastic uncertainty, we consider an elevation-based covariance as defined over here. Finally, the compass heading measurements are given a covariance as mentioned over here. Let's take a look at the trajectory planning results for a single UAS. Here is a simplified representation of the environment with the orange blocks denoting buildings that are higher than the flight altitude and yellow blocks denoting buildings that are shorter than the flight altitude. In the first part of the planner is to generate a graph of kinematically feasible trajectories within the environment. Once the graph is built, the planner then takes in the start state, the goal state, and plans trajectory between these states. Here is the output plan trajectory along with the predicted state uncertainty. Here we show the 3 sigma confidence sets for the predicted state uncertainty. Notice that all 1000 simulated trajectories along this plan trajectory remain within the predicted state uncertainty. This shows that the predicted state uncertainty is a good approximation of what the actual states might look during the execution. Hence, the trajectory planner safely leads the UAS to the goal under stochastic and bounded GNSS sensing uncertainties. Next, we consider the trajectory planning example in a shared airspace. Here again, we first begin by building the graph of kinematically feasible trajectories. Next, we consider the planning for a single UAS, which is termed as UAS-1, from a given start state to a goal state. And here is the planned trajectory from the planner. Once the trajectory has been planned for UAS-1, we consider UAS-2, where the start state is given as follows with the following goal state. Here, notice that the planner outputs a longer trajectory along the right-hand side of the environment in order to maintain collision safety of UAS-2 with respect to UAS-1. Next, we consider a third UAS as shown over here with the given start and goal states. Here again, the planner plans a trajectory in order to maintain collision safety with respect to UAS-1 and 2. Similarly, we consider the planner output for UAS-4 and 5 with the given start state and the given goal states. Here, note that even though the planned trajectory seems to geometrically intersect with the previous UAS, these trajectories do not temporally intersect with each other, thus maintaining collision safety. Again, we simulate 1000 trajectories along the planned trajectories, and here is an animation showing the safety of all UAVs. Thus, the trajectory planner is able to suitably plan collision-safe UAS trajectories in a shared urban airspace. Notice here that the predicted state uncertainties do not collide with each other, ensuring the collision safety of the UAS. So finally, here's the summary of our work. First, we improved our stochastic reachability and work for predicting state uncertainty under stochastic and bounded sensing uncertainties. Next, we designed a metric to represent the size of the predicted state uncertainty, which was used to compare trajectories in the planning framework. And finally, we demonstrated the applicability of the planner for GNSS-based navigation of fixed-wing UAS in urban environments. Thank you all.